the end of the day, both teams are trying to change the mindset of a person, right? For them, it's affluent people. For us, it's the people in the grassroots and the lower class. Therefore, they can't simply run away by saying these poor people are unshakable. They will never understand, and they will never try to understand, right? Because both sides have to concede that at some point, these people's mindsets will change. But how do we do that, right? Several responses to their side of the house. First of all, the reason that they've told you so far so many things, the reason they don't want to first show grassroots is simply because it's reasons that already exist in the current society. Like, for example, it's too hard to transition, there's too much pride, they don't have the access, they don't know how to donate, they don't understand why it's beneficial to them, several stuff. First of all, we think that the transition process will be easy once they have the incentive to do so, right? We think that incentive for these people can work in two ways. You have the moral incentive for them to understand why it's a must for them to do, even if it doesn't have any literal benefits, but only principally, right? And you have the financial benefits where you're going to pay these people, right? We think that at the end of the day, what they're going to do is, for example, financial benefits and financially incentivizing people, right? Even if they have full people on their side, this is only limited and not going to go that far, right? We think that the more important incentive to make sure these people do it is the moral one, right? This is exactly what we provide when we do grassroots. When we talk to people about why it's relevant for them to do so, when we make sure that they understand the urgency and why it's going to endanger them if they don't do that, right? It's even better on our side when there's aggressive socialization instead of instant policies that you don't understand why they exist, right? And furthermore, they try to argue about pride. We think that pride is even worse in affluent people. Why is this so? We think that rich people, despite having nothing to lose, they actually have a lot to lose it because it takes a lot of money and plays with reputation, right? Let's talk about rich people. These are the owners of companies. These are the multi-billionaire people, right? They don't have to worry about the efficiency of their monthly evaluation report. What they have to worry is about whether or not they are able to successfully strike a deal with the owner of the other company who is a conservative, whether they'll be able to make connections to people and other places, for example, and so on and so forth. If they support a failing motion, if they support a failing government, most likely they will, it will tarnish their reputation. So even if they support these social movements and advocacy groups, it's not going to be that harmful, and we think that the pride of these people is even more harmful than the other ones, right? And furthermore, they try to argue to you about how it's not going to be relatable to the poor people because they won't understand, but the poor people will relate but just don't know how to connect. Well, this is really weird because the most affluent people are usually in circles filled with academics, with people who have access to all these knowledge and all this proper education. We think that if anything, they are the ones who are constantly approached by different people on how to donate and so on and so forth. Like, they can simply access it on their own using the Wi-Fi that they have on their homes, right? But not the poor people. Exactly why we need to make sure that the movement, we need to focus on the grassroots movements because we need to make sure that it's relatable for them, right? For example, in green energy, we don't only talk about how climate change is doing that. We talk about how, for example, the price of water and the price of electricity is going up exactly because you have the problem of climate change. That's why if you want electricity to become even cheaper or if you want clear water, you need to combat the battle of green energy too, right? But also, they try to bring the first thing they try to bring the argument about how Indonesian people will only follow established rules because they have punishment, and second of all, about how society loves affluent people and their input, right? This is wrong because, first of all, they assume that Indonesian people still fear punishment. No, we can see in the case of, for example, how it's wrong for you to threaten your current president to cut his head off, for example, or how it's wrong for you to be part of the riots. They know the punishment is coming to them, but they are still doing it anyway. Why are they doing that? Because they will only do things that benefit their beliefs, right? One of their wishes coming true. Therefore, without grassroots, their wishes and the benefits that they want to achieve are very much different, and they will do anything to achieve their benefit, right? For example, if they don't like LGBT, then not following the rules will be okay to them because their benefit is no more LGBT. They won't resort to killing LGBT people without fearing the punishment, right? But furthermore, they try to say that the rich people are belief. We think that no, in the current sentiments, from the poor people to the top of fluent people are full of tension, right? Because they are aware of the benefits that they have, but they are also getting aware of the disparity. That's why they suspect corruption and hate corruption so very much. They hate the idea of people having this much money and not doing proper things with it, right? But what do they hate the most? Being spoken up for inaccurately, right? I'm going to explain in my argument why, even if their policy stance is going to be dangerous. First of all,